The Hudson's Bay Company was founded in 1670 to exploit the fur trade in the region. It was run by British stockholders in London. The company claimed the right to exclusive trade on the Hudson Bay watershed. This was changed by the annexation of New France into British North America. The British opened up Quebec for trade, which saw Americans and Scots enter Montreal to make money off the lucrative fur trade for themselves. They entered agreements to not trade in the same places, to keep fur prices lower, and this soon evolved into the Northwest Company, founded in 1779. The Northwest Company's trading strategy differed significantly from that of the Hudson's Bay Company. The Hudson's Bay Company would make established permanent posts for traders to sell fur at, or would trade with natives along the coast with their ships. However, the Northwest Company would instead use local people to acquire furs. They went to where the pelts were and established relationships with local native peoples. This caused the Hudson's Bay Company to rethink their strategy by placing more inland trading posts, as the Northwest Company were getting the best furs. An important difference between the two companies was their organization. The Northwest Company was a partnership where they were all equals. The older Hudson's Bay Company had a stricter hierarchy, with officers and salaried employees. Between the two companies, during their competition, the Hudson's Bay Company was at an advantage as they expanded, since they could rely on cheaper trade by ships at sea from Europe straight to the Hudson's Bay, while the Northwest Company relied on slower overland canoe routes to their headquarters in Montreal. In hopes of finding a faster and cheap trading route by sea, three explorers from the Northwest Company would explore modern-day British Columbia and Washington: Alexander Mackenzie, Simon Fraser, and David Thompson. Alexander Mackenzie made two voyages, both starting at Lake Athabasca. The first one in 1789, where he followed what is now called the Mackenzie River until reaching the Arctic Ocean. The second trip was in autumn 1792, where he stayed along the Peace River in the winter and reached the Pacific Ocean by the Bella Coola River. A new threat in the region was that of the burgeoning United States due to the 1803 Louisiana Purchase. In fact, President Thomas Jefferson read Mackenzie's published travels and realized the potential of the Pacific Northwest. This led to the famous Lewis and Clark Expedition, where they made a log cabin and hoisted a U.S. flag in the region. The War of 1812 saw the British take over the American-owned Fort Astoria. In 1813, the fort was renamed to Fort George in honor of King George. The fort was used by the Northwest Company as their headquarters in Oregon Country, but this was short-lived as the war ended in 1814 with the restoration of status quo ante bellum, a return to status quo prior to the war. On the 20th of October of 1818, the United States and Great Britain signed the Convention of 1818, which set the U.S.-Canada border at the 49th parallel west of the northwesternmost point of Lake of the Woods. This led to a strange exclave, as Lake of the Woods was less round than expected due to the cartography of the time. The 49th parallel would be the border until hitting the Rocky Mountains. The most important aspect of the treaty was that it stipulated that lands west of the Rockies would be free to both the US and Britain for the next 10 years. In 1827, this was made indefinite. Such a joint occupation of territory is called a condominium. One example is the New Hebrides condominium between the French and the British, now the Republic of Vanuatu. The territory was called Oregon Country by the Americans and Columbia District by the British. It is worth noting that both Russia and Spain together claimed the entire west coast of North America prior to the US and Britain. Spain forfeited their claims over the Pacific Northwest in the 1819 Adams-Onis Treaty. Both the United States and Britain set a new border with Russian America at latitude 54 degrees 40 minutes north in the Russo-American Treaty of 1824 and the Anglo-Russian Treaty of 1825. Now back to the Northwest Company. Its expansion and competition with the Hudson's Bay Company only weakened it due to lengthening supply lines and loose organization. In fact, the Hudson's Bay Company expanded into traditional Northwest Company territory by making a trading post in British Columbia in 1820. both companies actually struggled as fur prices rose rapidly. The competition ended when the two companies merged in 1821 as the Hudson's Bay Company. The ideology of manifest destiny spread in the United States, which changed things for Oregon Country and Columbia District, as it meant the Americans believed that ruling the continent from sea to sea was their destiny. The 1830s saw westward settlement promoted, with the first Americans staying in Fort Vancouver, benefiting from and trading with the Hudson's Bay Company. But as they grew, American settlers established a separate identity fomented by strong Methodist missionary leadership. Sir George Simpson, the governor-in-chief of Rupert's Land, originally believed that Britain would be able to keep the land north of the Columbia River in the territory, but this changed by the 1840s. In 1841, Sir George Simpson ordered for the headquarters of the Hudson's Bay Company to be moved from Fort Vancouver to Victoria, as he foresaw the loss of the region. Resenting the Hudson's Bay Company control, the American settlers set up an Oregon provisional government on May 2, 1843. They set up a 3-member executive committee alongside a 9-member legislative body. In 1844, they banned slavery, but the provisional government also banned black people from living in Oregon. The United States didn't really have the resources to colonize or make a large impact on the Pacific Northwest when it originally agreed to the Convention of 1818. They certainly could not compete with the Royal Navy or the organized efforts of the Hudson's Bay Company. Interest in the region grew starting in the 1830s as missionaries and settlers worked their way into the region. 4 petitions to Congress from the typically Methodist American settlers in Oregon were sent to the Senate from 1838 to 1845. Most of these bills ended up dying in committee or with no actions taken. It is worth noting that the last petition from June 1845 specifically petitioned for territorial status for Oregon. American settlement meant that by 1845, there were already over 5,000 Americans in Oregon country, mostly in the Willamette Valley, terminus of the Oregon Trail. The growing expansionist sentiment from the United States hit a high with the 1844 presidential elections. The Democratic Party made westward expansion a campaign goal, nominating candidate James K. Polk. Polk argued for the reoccupation of Oregon and the reannexation of Texas at the earliest practicable point. This was a compromise between Northern and Southern Democrats, especially as the issue of new free and slave states being admitted into the Union made westward expansion and manifest destiny more politically contentious. More militant Democrats used the slogan 5440 or fight in support of Polk's aims to annex the entirety of Oregon territory, up to the Russian border at 54 degrees 40 minutes north. This campaign successfully combined the expansionist sentiments of both Southern and Western Democrats to the point where candidate Henry Clay of the Whig Party had to support the annexation of Texas, though his support was lukewarm in comparison to the expansionism of the most militant Democrats, which threatened to start a war with Mexico over the Republic of Texas and Britain over Oregon country. It is worth noting that settlement by Hudson's Bay Company employees and traders differed greatly to that of American settlers in Oregon. The Hudson's Bay Company wished to preserve its monopoly and corporate control in the region and the fur trade, so it discouraged settlement and private land ownership in order to not dislocate native people on which the company relied on for the fur trade. This is in contrast to the American settlers who brought in a more individualistic and democratic ideology. They wanted privately owned plots of land and to participate in the government. One Hudson's Bay Company official spoke on the changes brought upon by the American settlements, stating that the fur trade much suffer by each innovation. All the changes brought on by the Americans were antithetical to the monopoly's function. Now, while the territory was a condominium with overlapping claims, it was expected for the territory to be split amongst the two nations, since it was unlikely for one to successfully claim the entire territory. The main area of dispute was north of the Columbia River, over Puget Sound and access to the Strait of Juan de Fuca. The British wanted access to the Columbia River due to its importance to the Hudson's Bay Company and as a harbor. The Americans wanted Puget Sound as Oregon south of the Columbia River had no good natural deep water harbors, and at the time, the ports of San Diego and San Francisco were Mexican cities, not yet part of the United States. For the British, the Pacific Northwest was isolated and bore little significance economically and strategically, certainly so in comparison to the rest of the British Empire. The decline of the fur trade and moving of the Hudson's Bay Company's headquarters to Fort Victoria only further justified British disinterest in strongly defending its claims. For the British, its goals were to prevent another war with the Americans and preserve profitable trade with the United States. These factors, however, didn't make negotiations any simpler for either party. At first, the British ambassador flat out rejected Polk's proposal of a border at the 49th parallel. The British reopened the talks upon hearing of this, but Polk hardened his stance to that of a border at 54 degrees 40 minutes north, as campaigned. A compromise was reached with a border at the 49th parallel, with Vancouver Island being the exception, the site of Fort Victoria. The Treaty of Oregon was ratified June 1846, soon after the outbreak of the Mexican-American War. Despite the wishes of some militant Democrats, the United States wanted to avoid a two-front war against both Britain and Mexico. The treaty was vague when it came to the ownership of the San Juan Islands. This led to a future border dispute called the Pig War, starting in 1859, that was mediated in 1872 by German Kaiser Wilhelm I, where it was resolved in the United States' favor. The Provisional Government of Oregon actually persisted until 1848 when Oregon Territory was created. Now, Oregon Country and Columbia District exist as the modern states of Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and the Canadian province of British Columbia. The legacy of the first Methodist settlers in the Willamette Valley persists, as the Willamette Valley is still home to the bulk of Oregon's population and prominent Oregonian cities such as Portland, Salem, and Eugene. I want to add that if the United States had somehow failed in annexing any territory north of the Columbia River, the United States' northwest would still border Vancouver, Canada. It would just happen to be Fort Vancouver, which is now Vancouver, Washington, and not modern-day Vancouver, British Columbia. Overall, the nation to gain the most from this affair was the United States. The remoteness of Columbia District, alongside the monopoly of the Hudson's Bay Company, made it so that interest in the region remained limited, especially since the Hudson's Bay Company's main focus was to turn a profit and satisfy their London-based stockholders, not recklessly expand British sovereignty over North America. Free market sentiments only made it so that the colonies would be judged on if they could turn a profit, as opposed to being defended steadfastly in the name of imperialism alone. The United States, while not fulfilling the most militant desires of annexing the entire Pacific Northwest, still in the end got the entirety of the most disputed territory, despite the more established British presence north of the Columbia River. Now, while the British and Americans were content with this deal, this would seem puzzling to the British North Americans and today the Canadians. But at the time, Canada was not a political entity. The Canadian Confederation would not exist until 1867. At the time, Canada was just a collection of British colonies in North America. So the British negotiated for their own benefit, not on behalf of whatever British North Americans wanted. This was a turning point for the future of Canada, since this was seen as a betrayal by London. It was seen as British weakness appeasing a strong United States. This helped separate their identity from that of being British. Ironically enough, some Democrats criticized President Polk for not sticking to the annexation of Oregon Country in its entirety.